Good morning, Your Honors. Richard Antonini on behalf of Barry Halajian, the appellant, and I'd like to reserve 3 minutes for rebuttal if I may. I guess I will start out your foreclosure warning, as you put it, Judge Brezon. Okay. I stand here in a peculiar position of having written the briefs in this case about several months before the law in California changed.
We know that. We've read the post Ivanova cases.
You've read Ivanova, of course, and then the Sciarrata case?
Yes.
Sciarrata versus U.S. Bank? Okay. This is essentially a Sciarrata versus U.S. Bank case. A little bit different, but the same theory holds. Under California law, as established in Ivanova, as a borrower, do have standing to assert a wrongful foreclosure case based on the allegation that a purported assignment of your deed of trust was void. Sciarrata holds that if an assignment of a deed of trust is done when there is no asset or loan to assign, then that is void per se. And what we have here is a situation where the original loan was issued to Mr. Halajian by an entity called Fremont Investment and Loan in 2005. In 2008, no one really disputes this. In August 2008, Fremont Investment and Loan goes out of business.
It goes out of business as a bank, but it doesn't dissolve.
Well, it's unclear what it does, Your Honor. It's unclear what it is. It surrenders its license to the California Department of Financial Affairs and conducts no more banking business. It's a little unclear what happens to it. It continues to defend cases, supposedly, but we don't know what it does beyond.
Isn't the problem here that MERS, you have to be attacking the whole MERS structure as well? Because MERS has the authority to act on behalf of agents and assigns anyway.
MERS has the authority to act as a transferring agent. It does not own interests and loan under its own bylaws. So if Fremont Investment and Loan were still around in 2010 when the assignment was done, late June, then that might be a proper assignment.
Did Fremont go bankrupt?
I'm not sure what it did, Your Honor. In fact, all we know is it surrenders its license and goes out of business. Was it acquired? Was it dissolved? No one knows. But that brings up another point. The defendants, particularly Deutsche Bank, acting for the trust, had the burden of proof to prove they had a valid assignment. That's under the Cockrell case. And since they were moving for summary judgment, they had to meet that.
Is that true in a wrongful foreclosure action?
Excuse me?
Is that true in a wrongful foreclosure action? Why isn't the burden on the plaintiff as it always is?
Because the plaintiff has to prove is a break in title or a void assignment. The other side then has to prove that they have a clear, unbroken chain of title and a valid assignment.
So what you would have to prove is that MERS did not have the authority as an agent to assign the DOT when it did. And you haven't proven that, have you?
Well, we put in evidence that Fremont did not exist as of April.
But you didn't put in evidence that Fremont didn't exist. You put in evidence that it wasn't a banking entity anymore.
Right. But even so, I think under the Cockrell case, they would have to prove they were the proper assignee of the loan, and they would have to establish that the loan went from Fremont to some other entity, to some other assign or successor of Fremont, so that MERS could assign it. I don't think MERS itself could hold hold the deed of trust or title of deed of trust. And X strictly is a nominee with the power only to transfer on behalf of its principal. If its principal is null,
is a question possibly naive. I apologize to you and my colleagues, but your client borrowed money from a lender. The lender, whatever happened, was out of existence. At that point, doesn't your client still owe money to somebody?
Yes.
Is your client making payments to somebody?
No. He owes money to someone, but he doesn't owe money to the world. And under the Ivanova case, it's not enough to say for a bank or a lender to come in and say, he owes the money to somebody. The bank has to come in and say, he owes the money to us, and here's the problem.
I understand that there is going to be a dispute among the wolves who are trying to collect, but just starting from your client, you acknowledge that at all times here, your client owed a loan that wasn't paid.
Yes.
Okay. That's the
point. So, again,
Counsel.
Yes,
Mr. Field, if I can interject. I'm troubled by, I think, maybe underlying Judge Trump's question as well. I mean, if Mr. Halajian received an amount of money and a large amount was still unpaid, like, how can the judicial result be he gets, like, money for nothing and the house for free, you know, that they can't work? That one of these entities can't recover against him.
The entity can recover against him if the entity can prove that it has a proper assignment of the loan. That's what the Ivanova case says. This argument, this point you bring up, the judge was dealt with in the Ivanova case where the Supreme Court said it is not enough to say that he owes the money to somebody. That somebody has to come forward and prove they own the loan and they have the right to foreclose. That's what Ivanova says quite clearly.
But the difference between this case and Sciarrata and also, I think, Alleging, which is the district court case, which found a void transaction, is that in those instances, as I understand it, what happened was the loan was sold to A first, and then later, or assigned to the Bank of America, for example, and then 5 years later, all of a sudden, it's being assigned to somebody else, and if it was already being held by Bank of America, it could be then assigned to somebody else, because the person assigning it didn't have it. Now, you're not claiming that. I mean, in other words, you don't have the somebody else here. You simply have this supposition that MERS couldn't have been acting for Fremont because Fremont was no longer a bank. That's essentially, MERS couldn't act for Fremont because Fremont, not that it was dissolved, but it was no longer licensed as a bank. So it must be that it couldn't act for it. And this thing just went off in the sky, not to somebody.
It is different from a Sciarrata case in that sense. We don't have the two assignments, sequential assignments like Sciarrata had. But it does show a break in title, and the problem is we don't know what happened to Fremont.
That's the problem. So why isn't that your burden? And then doesn't everything here turn into the burden of proof, and you're the plaintiff?
It turns into the burden of proof in a sense, but under California law, as established in the Cockerell case, and I think as said in the Ivanova case, the burden of proof initially is on the entity claiming to own the loan to actually prove that. In California, when you claim to have
an assignment. In a wrongful disclosure case.
Excuse me?
In a wrongful disclosure.
Yes. Ivanova and Sciarrata were both wrongful foreclosure cases.
And they say the burden is not on the plaintiff.
Right. And in California, the burden of proof has always been on the party claiming title to a contract under an assignment to prove the validity of the assignment. It would have been I think, simple for them to come forward with proof that Fremont, you know, what, first of all, what happened to Fremont? There was no proof of what happened to Fremont from the defense. Second, they could have proven that Fremont sold its assets, including this loan, to somebody else, and that this somebody else was a successor, and therefore Burrs could have signed the deed of trust. I mean, I see that, for example, in Washington Mutual cases where Washington Mutual went under, and then there was a contract between the FDIC and Chase, assigned and transferred all the Washington Mutual loans to Chase, and there, that Chase, by using that document, Chase could show it had an unbroken chain of title. Well, that's not what happened here. We don't have any indication. We always, you know, Judge Berzon, you're asking what happened to Fremont. We don't know what happened to Fremont. They presented no evidence to contradict our contention that Fremont had surrendered its license as of August 2008. They presented no evidence of what happened to Fremont or its assets. That would have been relatively simple to do. So that's really what it really does come down to, what happened to Fremont. And that gap in time.
Okay, got it. I don't mean you have to sit down. I mean, keep going if you want, or sit down. That's your place.
Right. The court has other questions.
All right, thank you very much.
So I'm coming up with my rebuttal time anyway.
Thank you.
Good morning, and may it please the court. Joseph Poppin on behalf of Appley, J.P. Morgan, Chase Bank, and A. Emily Elding, as counsel for Deutsche Bank as trustee, is present and has ceded her time so that I may argue. And I will conclude a few moments early as necessary so that Jonathan Weiss, as counsel for Whitney Cook, may argue on behalf of his client. I think a few issues that were just discussed need to be addressed first. This Sciarrata case was not cited in the briefs. He submitted no supplemental authorities.
All right, but we're hearing a bunch of these cases, and we have the case. Maybe we submitted some other case. We haven't.
I get it, but I'm not prepared to come and argue that case today. All I know about that case is it involved very unusual facts involving multiple assignments. So don't think.
And there was a second one like that, which was the Lundy District Court case.
Okay.
Right.
Okay. Well, my point is it hasn't been brought up prior to oral argument. Second, this discussion of Cockrell and the notion that the burden rests with the defendants to establish a complete chain of title is a misstatement of California law. It's well established that the party attacking a nonjudicial foreclosure sale bears the burden of showing the sale was illegal, oppressive, or fraudulent. And we've cited Melendrez, Knapp, DeBruner, Gomes, Haynes, all support that very fundamental proposition.
What about, is there a case law on the specific question of who has the burden with regard to chain of title? I mean, it would make logical sense that it should be not the plaintiff, because how are they supposed to know? But I don't know what the case law is.
I don't think it would make, I disagree with you that it would make logical sense. And I think there is a lot of cases, too, I think, that are most important for purposes of this argument on this issue and the entire, all of the argument raised by appellant. It are the recent cases in decisions in Yehudi versus Impact Funding and Satterbach versus J.P. Morgan. They raise the same arguments in this case. Mr. Antigini was counsel in both of those cases, and both courts rejected all of the arguments he's raising here today.
They also deal with Fremont.
I'm sorry?
They also deal with Fremont.
Of course, I anticipated that question. They did not deal with Fremont, but as I'll explain, the defunct lender theory is irrelevant and immaterial because, first, the foreclosing entity as a defendant does not bear the burden of establishing a complete chain of title. So,
you said that. What else?
Okay. That's why this defunct lender issue is irrelevant. What else about the defunct lender? In this case, the record.
What is the status? What is the role of MERS in all this? I mean, MERS is an agent which can, for the any successors as well as for Fremont.
Right.
We don't know if there were any successors, so we presume there were successors and that Bruce was acting on behalf of some successor or what? Did Bruce say who was acting on behalf of?
Could you say that again?
Did Bruce say who was acting on behalf of what it assigned or just decided?
He was acting on behalf of Deutsche Bank as trustee.
But did it say in the end? So there's some inference that there was an assignment to Deutsche Bank and that's why Bruce could act essentially.
Yes, absolutely. And I think the record confirms that.
Confirms what? I'm sorry.
Confirms that Deutsche Bank received the loan and MERS was acting on its behalf.
But we don't know from whom or what.
Well, I would point the court to paragraph 31 of the complaint that states the original lender sold plaintiff's promissory note to the GSAMP 2005 HE4 trust. The note was transferred and securitized into the trust. We've argued that's a judicial admission, showing that, in fact, the note was transferred to the trust. Under UNOVA, the deed of trust follows the note. So that's it. And the issue, they don't admit as to when it was transferred. But that issue is immaterial under Satterbach, Yehudi, Mendoza, because, as we know, an alleged untimely loan assignment to a loan trust is not void under New York or California law. It is merely voidable because the beneficiaries of the trust can ratify any action that doesn't comply with the terms of the PSA. So I think, and if you look at Judge Ishii's rulings, he numerous times says, you know, that the beneficial interest was transferred to Deutsche Bank. I mean, he says that in his footnote 1 on his MSJ order and page 7 on his MSJ order as well. There's just some question as to time. And I also don't think that the record shows anything about Fremont, quote unquote, going out of existence whatsoever. Footnote 3 to the motion to dismiss order noted that that Fremont was actively attempting to enforce its rights as a creditor as recently as May 2, 2012. The only evidence of that the plaintiff adduces to Fremont, even if this were issue was material, which I don't believe it is because we don't bear the burden of proof, but even if we did, the bulletin attached to the plaintiff's declaration purporting to show that Fremont surrendered its license in July of 2008 doesn't show anything about them being dissolved. And it doesn't show that they can't assign a loan. And it certainly doesn't show.
Earlier, and it would help me if you followed it up, that it doesn't matter because this was sold, it was assigned to the securitized trust, and then what? So then Fremont's out of the picture, is that what you're saying?
Absolutely.
And then what?
Then the Deutsche Bank has the loan. He fails to pay on it.
No, the Deutsche Bank. Is the Deutsche Bank as trustee for the security pool? Is that what it is?
Yes.
But the dispute seems to be how did that trust get it, not that it got it.
Well.
When did it get it?
As I mentioned, under the law, that's not relevant.
Okay.
How did it get it? I identified the judicial admission here. Paragraph 38. Plus, we adduced
the judicial admission isn't got it, but not how it got it. Is it?
Why would how they got it matter? If they got
it. It does all turn in the burden of proof, you're right. That's where it turns. But if you had a burden, then the question of how it got it would matter.
Right. Okay. Well, let's touch on the burden issue once again, because I haven't finished what I'd like to say about that. He's talking about Cockrell as being evidence that the the defendants bear the burden. Now, that is an issue, an argument he raised in Udy and that he raised in Satterbach. Both courts considered it and rejected it because in Cockrell and Neptune Society, which is the other case he cited, it was the plaintiff who had sued. So the plaintiff bore the burden of proof. Cockrell did not involve a nonjudicial foreclosure. Struck that. It didn't involve a claim for wrongful foreclosure, or it didn't involve an attack on a foreclosure sale. It was a claim to, it was a case involving claims to interpled funds. So the claimants, those of them that their claim was based on assignment, bore the burden of proof to show the validity of their assignment under common law principles. But as Yehudi and Satterbach rejected, the same argument because defendants have sued no one. As defendants, they do not bear the burden of proof. And I'll also point out that Satterbach cited Fontenot, which has a very appropriate discussion of this. It also discusses the fact that we're dealing with a nonjudicial foreclosure under California's civil code, which is comprehensive, and it doesn't require the foreclosing entity to adduce evidence of its authority to foreclose, and further that Fontenot has not been, or that it remains valid precedent after Ivanova, because Ivanova did not disapprove of Fontenot on that point. And then some more things about this. So in conclusion there, we don't bear the burden of proof. It's rather clear under Yehudi and Satterbach. Got some more points about this, about whatever evidence there was about Fremont. Like I say, the bulletin just shows they surrendered their license. It doesn't show that they couldn't sign a loan that they own or any other asset. It doesn't show that any assignment would be void. That is the standard under Ivanova, too. You have to establish a void assignment. And the only other evidence identified is this internet printout article. And this actually confirms that Fremont did not go out of existence. This is Exhibit A to Plaintiff's Declaration, which obviously is lacking in evidentiary foundation, but it's an internet printout. Even if you credit it, it states that Fremont, quote, will continue as a California corporation and will be changing its name to Fremont Reorganizing Corp. So there's no evidence that Fremont, quote, went out of existence whatsoever. And there's nothing in that printout that refers to this loan at all. So I think that the evidence there is just insufficient, and particularly in light of their admissions that the note was transferred to the trust and securitized into the trust. Further, I think the lower court's decision is correct on the issue, and the citation of the Silga case in other cases that have rejected this defunct original lender theory because the MERS deed of trust provides that MERS...
It is certainly conceivable that you could have a defunct original lender who just lost track of all these pieces of paper and loan, and somebody just shows up and purports to have inherited them all somehow and starts transferring them around. I mean, it's not a stupid and impossible situation. And that's why everything ends up turning on the burden of proof. In other words, I assume that if Fremont, in fact, went out of existence, and if 4 years later, MERS transfers the loan into this trust, and they could demonstrate that there really was a four-year gap between anybody ever having any asserted ownership interest, they might have something. I don't know why that's different than the dual owner. I mean, the fact is, suppose they went bankrupt and all their property was given to their creditors, and now somebody else is purporting was not the creditor. It's just purporting to enforce this.
Okay.
I assume they can't. No, they're at that point, there would be a gap similar to the dual transfer situation.
Why would that be? I mean, if they went out of business, if they went into bankruptcy, they still could have signed the loan.
Right.
But say that somehow through a reorganization, and they still own the loan in 09, which is not consistent with the record as it exists. But it's assuming that for the fact. And then they came up with a deal through bankruptcy.
Tell me why it's not consistent with the record.
Because the record shows the note was transferred to the trust.
When? But we don't know when.
It's immaterial when.
Well, it's immaterial if it matters whether it's before or after 09. I don't know that it does matter, but if it matters, then it's material.
It just matters.
That they didn't own it in 09. We don't know whether they owned it in 09 because we don't know when it was transferred to the trust.
I'm saying to establish a void loan assignment under Ivanova, to have standing, and the cases that have set forth, you have to establish the assignment was void. Okay? I don't see how any of this discussion would establish a void assignment. That's the problem. And any successor to the loan...
Well, an assignment for somebody who didn't own it because it didn't exist could be void.
Didn't? They didn't own
it because they didn't exist.
Well, there's no evidence if Fremont didn't.
Well, I know. I'm just talking hypotheticals at this point, right? I'm saying it's not a stupid theory if, in fact, they could prove it didn't exist.
Well, there is no authority supporting the appellant's position on this whatsoever. Sorry. There's no authority that says if a bank goes into bankruptcy or surrenders its license that the loan becomes a nullity or that it can no longer be assigned. I mean, it's really an absurd position to try to understand. I did want to provide some time for Mr. Weiss to say. So the only thing they'll say is Yehudi and Satterbeck are direct on point and ask the court.
Right. I assume you'll go ahead and say what you want to say very quickly.
Yes. Thank you, Your Honor. May it please the Court. Jonathan Weiss from Lee Whitney Cook. I just want to make three quick points with respect to the allegations directed against my client specifically, that she allegedly robo-signed foreclosure documents. I wanted to articulate why those allegations fail as a matter of law at the threshold. Number one, the borrower in this case lacks standing to make these allegations of robo-signing as a basis for voiding the assignment for the same reasons that the borrower lacked standing to allege that a post-closing transfer to the trust.
Basically, you're saying it's not void, it's voidable.
Exactly. They're subject to ratification. And this court in Kramer and McCarthy recognize that. That's the first point. But the second point is, and it goes to your question about the MERS system, Judge Berzon, is that this court recognized in the Cervantes decision that it's just a function of the MERS structure where you have this consortium of members, member banks, and mortgage lenders that you're naturally going to have a situation where employees of the member banks are going to be authorized by MERS to sign on behalf of MERS foreclosure documents.
And the robo-signing claim is that she didn't really sign it. That's a different issue.
Well, no. The robo-signing claim in this case, the factual predicate for that claim is that Ms. Cook wore too many hats.
I know.
She had a dual capacity.
That was in the cases, too. What else?
That's right. And then the third point is connected to that second point, which is that the cases after the district court issued its decision on the motion to dismiss, allowing the robo-signing allegations to survive to the summary judgment stage, have all come down following Cervantes and held that the mere allegation of robo-signing, and that's it, that's all you have when you strip away the dual capacity argument, the mere allegation that Ms. Cook is a known robo-signer is simply insufficient to support a claim at the pleading stage. So I'd say for those three reasons, I would respectfully submit that the robo-signing allegations don't survive the pleading stage, and you don't even need to get to summary judgment.
Okay, thank you very much. Sir?
Thank you, Your Honor. For three simple points. First, the district court I think, found correctly that it could not conclude exactly when the loan was transferred, if it ever was.
Right, but aren't they right, as your opposing client, that Yehudai several other cases are quite clear about the fact that the burden is on you as the plaintiff in a wrongful disclosure? Absolutely clear as they could be.
The burden is on us to show, I think, at least initially, a break in title, which I think we've shown by raising questions as to Fremont. Beyond that, I think under Cockrell, the burden shifts to them to show a clear chain of title, which they haven't done. What they have done is speculate.
Yehudai says that Cockrell is not a relevant case. Here, however, Deutsche Bank has sued no one. Yehudai, as the plaintiff challenging a nonjudicial disclosure, has the burden to prove her wrongful.
I don't think, and I think we met that burden, Your Honor, by at least bringing up the fact that the one really disputes is that that Fremont surrendered its license to do business into Mission Loans as of August 2008, which suggests that something happened to it. No one really knows.
Counsel, why does surrendering your ability to make loans mean that you can't make an assignment of some loan you already have?
It doesn't, Your Honor. It doesn't necessarily mean that, but again, we're engaging in speculation at this point, not evidence. We're trying to guess what happened.
And that's why you end up closing, because you have the burden of proof.
I don't think we have the burden of proof. At least not the ultimate burden of proof.
Unless we thought these two California Court of Appeals cases were wrong as a matter of California law, the California Supreme Court would rule otherwise. I don't know where we are, because they're pretty clear.
Well, the Cockrell case, I think, says they, as the assignee, have the burden of proof on proving the assignment. Ivanova says they have to show that they have the right to foreclose because they own the loan or somehow have the power to foreclose it. I think, and I might add that when it comes to burden of proof, it's often allocated to the party with access to the documents on the particular issue. And the issue here is the chain of title. And obviously, Mr. Halajian, as a borrower, doesn't have access to the documents that show the chain of title. Presumably, Deutsche Bank, which needs to certainly show it owns the loan, has access to the documents that show it has the right to enforce the loan. Last point, Your Honor, on when was this thing transferred? I've heard some talk of it was transferred to the trust in 2005. I would point out that when they moved for summary judgment, Deutsche Bank submitted a declaration from someone at Aqua Loan Services, a paralegal, I gather, who testified in their declaration they didn't acquire title to the loan until the assignment in 2010. Judge Ishii found he could know, no party had really proven when the loan was transferred.
Okay, your time is up. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank both of you for your education in the details of California foreclosure law. Halajian versus Deutsche Bank is submitted. And